So let's start with the personal questions.
Yeah, we had a lot of discussion in the chat. I've selected a couple of questions. Time and your speech definitely got people going with the automation. So there's a sort of two parts in this question. First of all, mainly from sort of the academic point of view. Now, when you know you had your customers sort of coming to scale up the assays and discuss about the assay development, what should they take into account before they come to you really about talking about the automation? So if you can still, you know, clarify maybe into a couple key points what they should take into consideration in the development of the assay and sort of bring those to you.
It's actually a really good question. I think one of the very first things is that we basically rely on someone bringing over an assay that actually works. And this may sound super logical, but in quite a lot of occasions, we actually see that this is not really the case, sadly. Also, automation equipment is not always as versatile as doing certain steps as we can do ourselves. Thinking of, let's say, if you want to remove media from a cell culture, if you do this manually, then you would pipette in an angle, you know, and this is something that automation equipment simply can't do. And we try typically with the people that we work with to modify the assay in such a way that we can make it work. And this is why we always rely on this stage of manual comparisons towards to the automation. We want to make sure that it works in both ways, basically.
Great. Thank you, Tijmen. I'll move directly to Jonathan then. Your speech was really, triggering again, sort of the discussion around the organoids and the questions there. There's actually a really practical question here. Based on the organoid studies you have seen, what is the most common readout or the type of assay that the people are using?
Well, that's a really good question. The most common readout actually is, I think it's trying to isolate the cells from the organoid and seeing the composition of what's making up the majority of that organoid. So is it differentiated? Has it still maintained its stem cell phenotype? So isolating the organoids, obviously, if they're using the grodase, and then it would be dissociating, and then using, I think it's mostly flow cytometry, to have a look at characterizing each of the different cell types based on the cell membrane.
And the final question that I chose from the chat is for Pia. So Pia talked a lot about the sort of in vitro aspects of EV cultivation and also the extraction of the EVs. But there was a question in the chat about you also pointed out in the last minutes of your talk about the clinical applications. So what are, in your opinion, sort of the most relevant clinical applications for the EVs? And you also mentioned that the different EVs could be suited for different applications. So can you give a couple of examples?
Oh, wow. That's a really broad question. So EVs are already sort of in a clinical use in from the bacterial outer membrane vesicles in vaccines. So that's where we are heading. But at the moment, there is lots of clinical trials going on. So obviously cancer, but you have so many other immune-related disorders where they are actually maybe heading even further. So for people who are interested, I suggest to look in the clinicaltrials.org and pick your favorite disease, and I would bet that you will find somebody doing some EV-related trial. So it's really like mushrooms in Finnish forest. Not this year, though.
Excellent. Johanna.
First of all, I'd like to ask the audience who would like to have a question. So please raise your hand up now. So there you can see the people. Okay. And before moving to the questions from the audience here, I have one general question. So I know all three of you are rooting for 3D cell culture. I love that, of course. But for sure, there are some cases where it just doesn't make sense to go from 2D to 3D. So when would you say that, okay, it doesn't make sense to go to 3D and rather stick with the 2D? So I will start from Tijmen.
That is actually also a very good question. I think a lot of at least I'm working mainly in the screening field. What I see a lot is that certain assays don't actually require to have any type of cell culture at all. Like, I think when you're very at the beginning of medicine research, where you just want to figure out whether your compound binds to your target of interest, you don't really need a cell line, and you definitely don't need a 3D cell line for that. But I think at the moment that you start thinking of translational projects, there I think it starts getting more and more important to use the correct cell model. We also have done this internally, where we compared basically screens done in 3D in organoids and comparing that to growing these same cells in 2D. And we just see that we get a very different type of hits when we are screening compounds in 2D versus 3D. So I think if you originally start screening your test compounds in a two-dimensional cell culture model, you're just getting different drugs and most likely not the ones that you actually need. And the fear is also that having these models basically have been used all the way since the beginning. So there might actually still be some kind of low-hanging fruit in the drug libraries that were tested back then, but where just the right compounds were not being picked up.
Mm-hmm. Right, thank you. So I guess if you could kind of summarize that you have the in silico to check, then you would have the first drug target to screen for is there anything, and then maybe look at the crossing the cell membrane, you could do still in like single cell or 2D. Yeah. But yeah. Then if you want to have more relevant responses in the screening, would be more in the 3D. How about Jonah?
Yeah, I think that's a really excellent answer. So really it's the zooming in on the level of what are you actually looking at. So if it's just passing the cell membrane, you can do that without needing to worry about it being in 3D, unless, of course, that pathway is dependent on a three-dimensional environment. The other thing that I would add is some of the cell types themselves actually don't want to grow in a 3D matrix. Mm-hmm. So that would be a waste. They tend to just grow in a suspension culture, or else you can get away with not worrying about having to put them in a matrix at all. So that's.
Would you have some
time.
Example?
Some of the blood cell types, I think, are they don't really want the matrix around. They just want to be free flowing. So that's what sure. That's their role.
How about in the EV world?
Well, thank you for this great question. So I can build on what Jonathan was saying. So that definitely, if you just need to penetrate the membrane, so imaging would be one thing where I would definitely at least stick to the first to the 2D. Actually, we were discussing in the Pfizer Journal Club this morning this issue, and very topical. So, and what I also would like to say that maybe the other way around, that where we want to have the 3D culture is functionality. Mm. So, but there you need to make something standard or the same, and then you can use the variables. Mm. So, if you want to have something similar as in past, then maybe that is in 2D, and then where you really want to see the functions or whatever, that would be in 3D. Mm.
Great. So now, once again, so the hands up for the audience here who want to have. So there we have one at the very end. Or
this is for Pia. I'm Jarkko Koivonen from Inflames flagship from Turku. About when I quickly already looked the article actually. So when you centrifuge the organoids, did you do any kind of EM or something to check the ultrastructure of these after the centrifuging and before? And do you think that because the shear stress has quite big effect on cells, that would it affect the content of the EVs, or what's happening there? Or does it have any effect? Is it so low, the stress there?
Okay, so we were asked to test the effect of the G-forces. So we did different kinds, and we didn't go to EM. We just looked at with the normal microscopy what we were showing the images for, and the cells seemed to be happy after that, so that we could do this continuous culture. So it was continued, for instance, for 11 days without any loss of viability. So that, now that I heard all this, I'm kind of thinking if I had heard it, we would probably not have done it this way. So, but luckily it seemed to work. And what I have been thinking though, that maybe there is some extra boost for the EV production of this manipulation. So that is something that we can't then avoid if we want to do this time-wise sampling.
Yeah, maybe I'd like to add to that, as some of the work that we saw come through Reading was, as the cells would be stressed more, they seem to have a higher EV secretion. So mm-hmm. it could be that during that centrifugation time, they responding to the movement of the hydrogel, and therefore they give out more EVs. So that could actually be an advantage. But they might be happy, but they're actually just responding. As we know with MSCs, they responsive cells. So
yes.
Definitely something to look into and keep in the back of your mind.
Yes. And yeah. I want
EM
to
would be really nice to check with EM to see the ultrasound. So you can see quite a lot with the EVs.
Yeah.
Yeah. Thank you. The EV structure or the spheroid structure?
Well, basically everything, not the EV structure, but the cells, how they are behaving before and after, because that could tell maybe about the mechanism, what's happening there.
And where you have to be gentle is the resuspension. There you can't just, so you have to be gentle at a certain stage.
I would like to now move on to the next question. I think we have a question over there.
Hi everyone, and thank you for excellent presentations. I'm Melina Malinen from Orion Pharma, and I have a question to Tijmen. I pronounced the name.
No worries.
But actually, I was interested how you measure the efficacy of the FDA compounds, the drugs.
This was a cell viability measurement. So basically what we are interested in, because it's a tumor organoid model, we are interested in finding drugs basically that lower the viability of these tumors, basically. And so we use Promega cell titer glow 3D model for that. Basically it's basically a detection of the amount of ATP in the wells.
And then second question to you is that was it homemade, or what was the instrument that you were actually printing or pipetting? The
Certus?
The Certus Flex. So this is an instrument made by Giger AG. It's a Swiss company. And it is a dispenser that works with valves. So it's not a pump-based instrument, but so most dispensers, they have peristaltic pumps where they push liquid through tubes. And this also leads to quite high dead volume. So this is why we like the idea of the Certus Flex, because what this device can do, basically you can attach syringes to a valve that they develop, and this works with electromagnetism basically. So you can open and close the valve, and the opening time dictates how much liquid you're actually dispensing.
Thank you.
Thank you. I think we had one more question here, just right in front of you. No, there.
Hello. Hi, my name is Martin Melvick. I'm from Axiom Biosystems. I had a question for Pia. I was very intrigued about the EVs, and I wanted to know a little bit. You mentioned they can be used as a therapeutic vehicle. And so during the pandemic, we saw a big rise of the viral vehicles. And so I just wanted to ask, what kind of advantages or disadvantages do you see with the EUVs being used as a vehicle as opposed to the viral vector vehicles?
Oh, wow.
Yeah.
I think that there is probably still a need for both. So with the EVs, I see more troubles at the moment. So with for instance, how to standardize, we've been discussing how important that is. So that getting the batch variability to reduced, and also obtaining enough material. So these are big hurdles. So what I'm don't work with the therapeutic EVs, although I would like to our platelet EVs maybe someday to be that kind. But what I know from the MSC field is that they have big issues with finding the sort of the what is the potential, the therapeutic potential, and how to obtain it in the constant manner in the productions. So then using the same vehicles for drug delivery, I think that we are facing the same issues. So because they are so much more biological than the viruses that are not necessarily considered to be alive, we can continue this debate over the dinner, so that we have all those massive variability. So I think that's the biggest hurdle. So sorry, I'm answering the opposite to your question.
No, that's great. I'd love to continue this discussion during dinner.
Thank you. There was one more question just next.
Yeah, thank you. Itral from Selink. It's amazing what you've achieved in the high throughput space and also the examples presented by UPM. There's just one question I have related to if you have noticed or explored the material retention of small molecules, or if that is something that you've investigated or created thresholds for. Just an example, we know that extracellular matrix, when we use drugs for treatment, for example, differs a lot from, for example, NFC in the Grodex. Have you looked at compounds being retained by the material? And if so, what was your observation? That's number one. Second, have you also compared to traditional spheroids or organoids created in traditional ways, for example, using hanging drop, compared to encapsulating in the Grodex?
I mean, it's a very good point. So the first part of your question, whether compounds are retained in any form of matrix. At first it was also a bit of a worry that we had translating, let's say, the assay that we had where the organoids were growing on top of the matrigel, basically, to the organoids developing inside the Grodex. So this was a worry from us. I think the whole notice that basically after multiple years in between the different assays, we have a 77% overlap of hits, shows that that is probably not such a big issue. I think it probably also depends on the type of compounds that you are selecting for testing, right? I think probably if you're using untested molecules, the chance is a bit bigger than for molecules that are going or that are in the clinic available, basically, because these are very well established molecules typically, and we know a lot about them already. So for the first part of the question, I think it is very difficult also to establish for each of the molecules whether they are being retained in the gel. I think especially for untested molecules. Then the second part of the question, whether we did do comparisons with other models, we did simply not do that. No, so we basically only used a gel-based model in this case, also because the typical hanging drop models, for example, they are not so suitable for the automation equipment that we have. So this would have been a manual comparison that we would do. One reason being actually that for the acoustic dispensing that we are using, you saw in the video, basically the destination plate is being inverted. This simply does not work with 96 well plates because the capillary forces are not strong enough to keep the spheroids and the media inside your plate. So that's just a very practical consideration there.
I don't know if Jonna wants to comment.
Yeah, definitely. So I can chat with you more about it. We have had a look at different drug compounds loaded into the hydrogels, whether they positively or negatively charged. And for example, with the ANFC, which is anionic, you do get some interaction, but it can actually be used as an advantage for slower release or faster release, depending on the compound. And then also the density of the hydrogel, basically, like I showed, the porosity varies depending on the density of the hydrogel. So, and then the last part with regards to the different addition. Sorry, I've actually just lost the point. So I saw the red screen and that's what distracted me. So I'll chat to you about that afterwards.
But maybe it's a good cue for the coffee break.
Yeah, exactly.
So thank you once again, Tijmen, Jonathan and Pia for your presentations and for answering the tough questions from the audience and from the online. And now we will move to the coffee break, which will be 20 minutes, is it?
Yeah.
20 minutes, so we will reconvene 35 past whatever hour you are on online. So see you later.